This is a story by a man by the name of Julaybib, who was not a handsome looking man, Damim al-Wajh. He was a man who was not handsome looking, and he used to be a slave, and he had some physical ailments, and he used to enter upon the women of the Ansar, meaning they didn't even consider him to be someone to be shy in front of. Normally, the Muslim women, if a man comes into their vicinity, they would cover themselves as they did with Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu on many occasions because of their modesty and their shyness. However, Julaybib had the luxury of walking around with the women, playing with the women, joking with them, because they didn't even consider him to be someone that they needed to be shy in front of. That just shows you the level of how they viewed him in their society. And even today in Saudi Arabia, you'll have some of the servants or the maids over there, the drivers, who the women uncover in front of him because they don't even consider him to be a human being. They don't even consider him to be a man, someone that they need to be shy in front of. So you'll find that the driver, maybe he's African, maybe he's Bangladeshi, and he drives around the women, but the women sometimes they uncover in front of him because they don't feel that it's someone that they need to be shy in front of. But if the father was to bring a guest over or someone like that, they would definitely put the hijab on in front of him because they consider him to be someone of social status, someone that they have to cover in front of. Just to show you in society, in certain societies, how people are viewed. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he always rooted for the underdog, always for the person who was a nobody, the person who no one considered to be anyone, just as he did with the black woman who used to clean the masjid, who the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum prayed over. They didn't even pray over her. They buried her. When she died, they didn't even pray over her. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asked them, "Hala akhbartumuni? Why didn't you just tell me that the woman died?" And he walked over to the woman's grave and he prayed over her, because they considered her to be nothing. But to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he always considered the underdog to be the most important. So this man Julaybib, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used his influence as the imam to advocate for him to get married, knowing that no one in the society would marry him. So he went to a man from the Ansar. So one of the men from the Ansar, he told his wife, "Do not allow Julaybib to come amongst you." He said, "Because if Julaybib comes amongst you today, I'm going to do such and such and such and such." Because he was still a man, and he's still someone that the women needed to be shy in front of. So the Prophet ﷺ, on one occasion, he said to the man, a man from the Ansar whose husband died, he said to her, "Give me your daughter in marriage. Zawajini ibnatak, give me your daughter in marriage." So the man thought the Prophet ﷺ wanted her for himself. So he said, "Ni'mat ayn wa karama." He said, "How great is this? This is a blessing. Absolutely, you can take my daughter in marriage." You see, when someone comes of high social status, we'll marry her off very quickly. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Inni lastu uriduha li nafsi." I don't want to marry her for myself. The man said, "Well, then who?" He said, "For Julaybib." The man said, "Oh, wait a minute. I got to go check with his mother," right? Even in that society, men didn't just marry their women off. And as I mentioned before, that the women from the Ansar were a lot different from the women of the Muhajireen. The immigrant women who came from Mecca to Medina, they were a lot different than the women of Medina. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, "Nahnu ma'ashar al-muhajirin, ya'ni ahlu Mecca, kunna naghribu nisa'ana, falamma intaqalna ila Medina, ra'aytuhum unasan yaglibnahum nisa'uhum." He said that we, the people of Mecca, we were more aggressive and more assertive than our women. He said, but then when we migrated to Medina, we found the people of Medina, their women are more aggressive than they are. So he said, "Let me check. Let me check with his mother first." So he went home and he told the wife, his wife, that the Prophet ﷺ wants your daughter in marriage. The woman said, "This is a blessing. How great a blessing this is. Give him to her. Give him the daughter." So the husband said, "No, he doesn't want the daughter for himself." The wife says, "Well, who does she want? Who does he want her for?" And the husband says, "He wants your daughter for Julaybib." The mother hit the fan. "No, I will never marry my daughter to Julaybib. Abadan, I will never marry my daughter to Julaybib." And the daughter overheard the conversation. So the daughter came out and says, Who's asking for me in marriage? So they explained to the daughter what was happening, and the daughter said, do you think that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would marry me to someone يُضَيِّعْنِي that would waste me, would waste my right away, would not give me my rights? Give me to the Messenger of Allah and let him do with me what he sees fit. And so they gave the daughter to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he married the daughter to Julaybib. Subhanallah al-Azim. And this is something that is very important, because you have many Muslims who embrace Islam, accept Islam. And sometimes they accept Islam in communities that are predominantly immigrant communities. Arab, Pakistani, Indo-Pak. And they may be African-American, they may be Caucasian, they may be Hispanic. And they embrace Islam in these communities. And they will dwell in these communities for years, and no one would ever to think to marry them to their daughters. Abadan. We see these individuals in the community for years, year after year go by, practicing Muslims, trying to practice Islam, and we would never think to marry one of our daughters to these individuals. And it's a disparity, and it goes on in many Islamic communities. And I, much like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I always like to advocate for the underdog, because I was once one of those individuals. 2 years I lingered in a community with no one to marry. 2 years. No one once came to me and said, you know, are you looking to get married, brother? Which is why when I became the imam, I made it a point. Anytime I saw a young brother on the musalla, I would always stop and ask, are you married? Do you work? Do you have a job? Are you looking to get married? And I would always go out of my way to try to pair him with someone to get him married. Because as we mentioned before, this is half of your deen. And there's nothing more than a young man to see, you know, good in a woman that is an equal to him, that he could marry, that inshallah ta'ala would turn out to be a good situation. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he married the girl to Julaybib. And then he made dua for her. He said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you with much wealth. And Julaybib was martyred in one of the battles, not too long after he married her. And this woman was one of the widows of the Ansar, and she was the most wealthiest women from amongst the widows of the Ansar, because of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when Julaybib died, the Sahaba were around him crying because of his wealth, because of his worth in the community. And then they buried him without praying over him, because he died as a martyr. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, ana minhu wa huwa minni, that he is from me and I am from him. There's no difference. لا فرق بين عربي وعجمي إلا بتقوى الله. There's no difference between an Arab and a non-Arab except with taqwa. There's no fadl over a white man, over a black man, over an Arab and a non-Arab except with taqwa, except with piety and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أنا منه وهو مني. I'm from him and he is from me. There's no difference between me and him. And this is something that, a lesson that we have yet to learn in the Islamic communities here in America, in North America. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his tawfiq. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his forgiveness for any shortcomings that we have had in this regard. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama tasliman kathira. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.